Afternoon to everyone. I am very glad to welcome you to the 37th in the STIP Forum lecture series being held online since November 2020. I thank our partners, TERI, India Habitat Center, CEFIPRA, and Vigyan Prasar for their cooperation and support for organizing these STIP Forum lectures. I warmly welcome and thank all our attendees for their interest and support, and of course, our eminent speakers. I have the honor to introduce our chair for today's session. Dr. Devapriya Datta is presently the head of the Science for Equity, Empowerment and Development, SEED Division at Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He has worked at the Central Soil and Water Conservation Research and Training Institute, Dehradun, and as Counselor, Science and Technology at the Embassy of India, Washington, D.C., and also was the director of the Indo-French Center for the Promotion of Advanced Research, CEFIPRA. He has been a UNDP visiting scientist at the Blackland Soil and Water Research Institute, USA. He has a PhD from the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi, and joined the National Agricultural Research Service, ICAR. He was a postdoctoral fellow at the International Institute for Geoinformation Science and Earth Observation in the Netherlands. He was awarded a Senior Professional Research Fellowship on Groundwater Governance from International Water Management Institute, Sri Lanka. His areas of expertise and research interests are application of geoinformatics for natural resources management, watershed management, geoinformation management, and capacity building. He has a number of publications on national and international journals and has authored 3 books. Today's session is on food processing and rural economy, technological options for farmers and self-help groups. The main speaker is Dr. Ashutosh Upadhyay, Professor, Department of Food Science and Technology and Dean Academic National Institute of Food Technology, Entrepreneurship and Management, NIFTEN. Dr. Upadhyay was a faculty member of the Center for Food Science and Technology at BHU. He has worked extensively in food processing technologies and undertaken many projects nationally and internationally. He has a Best Science Research Award by the MP Council of Science and Technology. As you know, food processing technology is critical for assuring farmers' incomes, nutrition, and sound environmental management of wastes related to food processing and consumption. Given India's huge agriculture sector, the importance of food processing technology cannot be overemphasized. If we make progress in this field, we can also share our technology with many developing countries where the agricultural sector is an important asset. I'm sure today's session will enlighten us on this important subject. I would now like to invite Shri Sunit Tandon, Director IHC, to make his remarks, following which our chairman, Dr. Devapriya Datta, will take over the session. So over to you, Shri Tandon.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Balakrishnan. Thank you for that wonderful, valuable introduction to our chair and to our speaker for this 37th STIP lecture. I just wish to say how pleased we are at India Habitat Center that so many of our institutions have collaborated on this series. We've been going for over 2 years and we made a switch over to the virtual mode from the physical mode because of the pandemic. And I just wish to say I was exchanging this before this meeting actually formally started. I was saying that now we are going back to the physical mode, and I would encourage the institutions concerned to consider coming back to doing it in physical mode, perhaps also additionally in a hybrid virtual mode as well. So with that, I would just like to say how pleased I am that the series has managed to surmount the obstacles faced during the pandemic and continue. And it's very valuable work, and to welcome Dr. Upadhyay, our speaker, and our chair, Dr. Datta. Thank you very much indeed. I must excuse myself because I have some other engagements which I have to carry on for. They're pressing. So please kindly excuse me from the remaining part of this session. And I wish you all the very best for this wonderful session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tandon. Over to you, Dr. Datta. I would encourage the attendees to post their questions and comments in the chat box, please. Dr. Datta, floor is yours.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Balakrishnan. And thank you, Sunitji, for your introductions. And Sunitji, especially the India Habitat Center to be a partner to this valuable STIP forum lecture series, and today being the 38th day, it has some sort of an emotional relations with me, because when I was a CEFIPRA director, we are discussing this with this lecture series with India Habitat Center, then subsequently my successors took it up, and then now it is in reality and it's 38th, so it shows that it has already taken up this steam. And as a result, I thank on behalf of CEFIPRA, because I don't see CEFIPRA director here, to India Habitat Center and the director, Mr. Tandon, to be a very the patient and active partner in this journey. So today's the discussions and the 38th the lecture is on the food processing and the rural economy and the technological options for the farmers and the self-help groups. So if we see here, I just want to do before Dr. Upadhyay take it, the overall the context, I think we can look this issue from a macro and the micro two issues. The macro issue that, as you know, the agriculture in India, we are self-sufficient. During this pandemic situation, forget about the post-pandemic, the sector which has done exceedingly well is again our agricultural productions in terms of new records. Every year we have a new records without saying that the data. But still, the gap remains in this, our food security and the food sufficiency. So there is a gap between the food, the crop productions and the food, the food sufficiency and the food security. In Indian average, household, it spends about 45% of its expenditures on the food. And it's become very much, the challenging by, it is estimated by 2027, by surpassing India by China, the India will be the, the most populous nation. So we have to really cater to many more, the mouths to feed. And also that becomes more, challenging due to the climate change and the degradations of the natural resources, air, water, land, and so on. So on the other hand, if you see the agricultural, the evolutions of the India's agricultural pathway, it is going towards the food, and an important component of that is the nutrition component. One hand, we have to handle the malnutrition to be healthy diets, undernutrition, micronutrient deficiency, the overnutrition issues. On the other hand, as the per capita income grows, there will be much higher demand for the high value agricultural products. And this would be in line with as Bennett's law of food consumption, which states that with rising income, people consume relatively less starchy staples and shift to more nutritious food with protein and vitamin. And in this changing scenario, we have to look at it into our food processing sector. And if you see the Atmanirbhar Bharat, the call for our Honorable Prime Minister, at the core of it is the technology. And the technology in the agricultural sector, if you see, the food processing sector has been given a very special role for in the context of the farm to fork in that context. Now, if you look at from the micro perspective, because since Dr. Patel is going to talk from the point of view of the farmers and the self-help groups, we have to put this, the technology in the context of a requirement of our livelihoods. Because generally in our country, our developmental processes from the science, technology, and innovation perspective has been thought about technologically driven. But in these 75 years today, when we are celebrating the Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav, that model probably needs relook. We need to look it from the point of view of the livelihood systems. The system's weakest point, weakest link needs to be improved through the technology, the introductions, because each of the livelihood system has its weakest link. At the same time, each of the livelihood system also has a strongest link. And in the context, we have to look into the technology interventions to improve that by constituting the social entrepreneurships. Now, in this context, today's discussions in the food processing and the rural economic development, we will hear it from Dr. Ashutosh Upadhyay, whose introductions already Ambassador Balakrishnan has given. And without much ado, and in order to overcome that the technological glitches which all of us have faced, now I invite Dr. Ashutosh Upadhyay to to listen to your experience, and then we can discuss about in this context, in this framework, and how we can go ahead and can create the example of the sustainable development goal, especially the 1 and 2 at the field level. Because always I believe the SDG operates at the 3 level, one at the UN level of 32,000 feet width, at a national level as a 15,000 view, but the real SDG takes place at the field of the farmers, which is the 10 feet view, and that's the reality. With that, Dr. Ashutosh Upadhyay.
Thank you very much, sir, respected chair, the panelists here, and particularly the organizers and Ambassador Bhaskar Balakrishnan Saab, thank you very much for introducing me. So my name, Ashutosh Upadhyay, that was enough, that representing NIFTEP, but you have said so nice word. Thank you very much, sir. And I'm glad that I have the person who from the DST who is heading the SEED. And SEED is a division which deals with the technology development too, and for the rural sector. So I would be really eagerly looking forward for the remark of the chair when I could conclude my talk. So that's the wonderful part of this session, I feel. And also the August audience, which we are connected with this virtual platform. Thanking to RIS connecting to this audience here today. So I would be talking in terms of my PowerPoint presentation. So I'm quickly sharing it, and my apology on the technical glitch, which all of a sudden happened. And so now I think all set, and I hope that my slides would be visible. And
yes, sir.
When we are talking in terms of food processing and rural economy, and particularly that we want to discuss on technological options for farmers and self-help groups. So in this, I have structured my talk today. Setting the context means there is rural, there is economy, there are technology. So the context in which I would be talking, I would first take a minute for it, and then sector specific technology solutions. And here I have taken a I have tried to merge the canvas of different technical institutions and national institutions in India who have worked in this regard have come up with some technology solutions. NIFTEM, the institution which I am representing, is just a young 10-year existence as on date. So I have tried to take up all possible which I feel that could be relevant and important in the context. And then specifically NIFTEM ecosystem, and particularly for the audience who is from Delhi and nearby, they can connect. And then would highlight that what way people have taken up the technology development which have gone last 75 years post independence in the country. And it would be very relevant, and it would not be correct on my part if I miss to talk about PMFME, whereby the micro sector formalization is being taken up by Government of India. So with this, I would like to conclude. For the context, when we say that rural versus urban in terms of a number game, what is rural and what is an urban, there could be different distinctions. There could be RBI definition, there could be census definition, but in terms of number, if we see that what is a rural population versus the 134 that billion which we talk 1.34 billion which we talk we have in India, so it is a substantial number which is there in terms of the population. In terms of the GDP and the rural national income, which we count, so that is just half. So that's the significance of the rural pockets of the country is. And with this, within the narrow context, if we see that the rural economy could be sometimes be limited, or means be thought to be limited to agriculture, and thereby the agriculture contribution of the GDP on date, we were agrarian economy at a time, but not today, if I can say so. And so that could be the limited aspect of rural economy. But the important aspect of this rural versus urban fact is that rural potential, which has been given as a means a background which we have in the country, where from the technology, and particularly we talk the food technology revolution can take place, which has, I think, is taking shape for last 15 years or so. So we are blessed with good climatic conditions, varied climatic zones, different types of the soils. So on that ground, we are able to achieve the world first, second, third rank in different productions. All agro resources, if we talk, whether it is a food production, milk, spices, fruits, vegetable, grains, or so. So that's the strength or that's the potential which we have, and where the talk would be focusing. In terms of the rural economy, this is the one way of defining rural economy by the Economist, or this is a taken from Yes Bank, one of the report. So when they take the rural economy, means the total economic activity which is in the rural context. So, but certainly I would not be touching this whole span, and for me the context of presentation would be focusing to the supply chain. The whole supply chain is there. At the one end there is a farmer, or there is a producer which we name farmer, and at the end there is a consumer. So whatever happens in between in this, and so is there any opportunity, or if our bunches of the farmers and SHGs, how the technology is helping that farmers and SHGs can take that up. So that's the pure context. Though I mentioned some of the points in terms of the strength, but specifically talking in terms of the food processing in the country, it would be relevant to mention that when we talk of the food processing in the country, and this is the state of affairs even today, that it is largely handled by either small scale industries or the unorganized sector. Even the many small scale industry, they can also be called unorganized, and very limited volume of this agro resources which we have is handled for the processing, which could be secondary or tertiary processing by the organized sector. So that's a very, very important part. Means this is there is already in existence, and the small players are giving this economy a push. Now food processing industry is such an industry which is dependent on the agro resources. So something which is dependent on agro resources means industry at one end and forward it is direction it is looking for the consumers, but backward linkages are very, very important if you want to source a good amount of good quantity or quality of the raw material, or you want to take up the ingredients for your processing. In terms of the agro industry at village, at the rural level, the NAWARD has highlighted that in terms of the number enterprises, in terms of the total employment, in terms of the gross value which they are adding, this is a significant number. And but important is that who is really doing this at this level. As on date, when we have a structure like farmers producer organization, farmer producer companies, SHGs, so all these are the players which have now really contributing for the same. So in this context, in very plain term, if we say that what really that processing is, every household there is a processing. Means we eat food and on daily basis, that's a processing. If we make curd out of milk, that's a processing. And the value which is added, if the milk is at 50 rupees a kg and curd is sold at 100 rupees a kg. So that's that kind of value addition which I want to highlight in this picture, that what value addition plays, and what is the share which our farmers and SHG can really look for in this value chain. And if there is the means for this is the food processing, and then food processing at three different levels in particular, and where really the farmers can play a role or the SHGs can play a role. For sure, the primary processing level, which says about the cleaning, sorting, grading, and the even some cooling, farming, moving the field heat for agro produce activities, which now also taking over, and there is a preference that in some of the large or larger role, which is a spoke and hub kind of role, where there could be the small feeding units. They can cater to something which is as a center, a secondary level processing, or the primary processing one or primary processing two, if we could divide. So that is the important area where they can really play. Yeah, some of the items can also be picked from secondary processing side, particularly if it is the spice, if it is some oil, hand means which are kachi ghani kind of oil, which we very well know and now being preferred by the consumers as a mustard kachi ghani oil. So that's the overall scenario. So I'm going sector by sector and first taking up the dairy processing. Dairy processing, why I took the dairy processing first? Because we are first in the dairy milk production. So that's the one region. And the second region is, this is the single commodity where we have achieved a fairly good level of processing already. So thanks to the revolution, which and thanks to Professor Kurian, that revolution which made it possible, that cooperative revolution in Gujarat. And that probably copied by the country, and the milk is one single commodity which has more than 35% of milk which is processed as of date. So that's the one single commodity has that much. Otherwise, we are less than 10% in almost all. Otherwise, close to 5%, I'll say. So if we see this, the production stats and the what kind of till 2018, approximately 80% of the milk which was processing in market, and that was unorganized sector. What unorganized sector? It could be a lassi vendor, it could be somebody who is preparing sweets and so on. So milk processing, that economic activity also contribute for this processing. However, milk is another reason for taking the milk first, that milk is very sensitive commodity, very highly perishable commodity, and consumption pattern is one thing which probably I'll say that hampers processing in a way, because every day we prefer to have a milk which is a fresh milk, and even there are preferences that where people don't like to have the pasteurized milk. So that is limitation, but still there is a good possibility, good potential which exists in the value chain of the dairy which we talk. The cooperatives at the one end, which is there, they have a definite setup, they have a collection centers, they have a it's a really spoke and hub model which really works here. But there is a space where is if we really look that what is the space which a farmer or SHG can really found in this value chain, where it is said that even a small players, a small processor find it difficult to compete with the brand like if it is a mother dairy, if the brand like Amul. So if we are really looking for it, and do we really have sufficient plant and machinery and equipments for this, if we are thinking for a small scale processors? Yes, there are solutions available. It is important that that what really they opt to process. So if we talk in terms of the milk tank, which could be which could store some milk for them, and the surplus of the milk, if it could be stored, and do we really need to have it pasteurized, and or only the chilling will help? So that can be decided. There are batch models of the pasteurizers are available. Simple hot water can be sufficient. So those kind of even plate heat exchangers are available with they runs with the water. And this is a tool which has been wrongly used in dairy. Means people were taking the fat away from the milk, so for that separator has been used. But if somebody is really looking for an organized business, then he could be a legal user of the separator as well. The one important product which is ghee, which still people depends on the unorganized market. Yeah, organized players are certainly there, but still people prefer to buy it at the blaze site. And so for them, this is good that if somebody is using butter churners, they would be able to handle large volume of the creams. And at a standalone or for a limited market approaches, there are possibility in the ice cream also, which I foresee for some of the SHGs, not exactly the FPOs and farmers, but SHGs can really explore for the ice cream, and particularly the ice cream of varied nature, varied value in terms of its ingredients, flavors, which they can offer. And lastly, the paneer, which is certainly, if you see that a milk vendor or even a sabji wala, both could be the source or the selling point for this paneer. And a good paneer, people really look, still they like to have the fresh paneer rather than the vacuum packed paneer. Though there are doubt in quality, there are people, but if the brand could be made reliable, then certainly this could also be a possibility. The farmers which really are looking for a good storage of the milk, which they want to aggregate within themselves, because if you have a volume, you will have the power of the bargain. So if the farmer producer organizations want to have a solution at the rural site, this is a good machine which has come up, which comes in the varied capacity, which is active bulk cooler. It is off-grid solution is available, so partially electrified area where the limited power is available. This works well. It could be solar or it could be battery based. So inverter kind of arrangement is there, and you can have your milk shelf life for whatever the supply chain if you want. Means this is something which is what happens initially. Now the milk has to travel up to a chilling center. So this is something at the village you can take the milk which is chilling, and those some insulated cans it can go, and you can get a better price, better quality of the milk ultimately that the processor can receive. So this is one good options which I see I can offer through this presentation to the audience. Now coming to the SHG level or individual farmer level, I see, and I personally convinced that when I say that the brand which are not able to compete Amul or not able to compete Mother Dairy, but the limitations of the Mother Dairy and the Amul is that they cannot really cater to the niche market. So if we have the traditional things like there is Khurja Khurchan, or there is some Rabdi of Haryana, or those kind of products, they can be very well handled, and probably can only be handled by these small processors. And here, if I talk in terms of the curd, which is a normal dahi, and how do we present, and the dahi of the which is either earthen pots are used to have that curd processed within that, or even delivering it. So that is one USP which people can really make it. And make it important is that how hygienically, so that needs some skill development, some awareness kind of thing. And second important, I mentioned already that ghee, though that's a misbranding. People nowadays selling ghee, which is in name of the A2 ghee. So A1, A2 milk is there. So, but yes, certainly A2 milk can be really thought of, which is from the Indian breeds. And that is one opportunity for the self-help group if they have the source of the milk, which is from the some Indian breeds. But ghee is important in terms of when I say that a rural source, people prefer it for its flavor. I have seen even the big brands, they have different way of processing ghee, targeting to the south market, targeting to the north market, different extent of flavor preference, taking either cream and then ripening it, or if or we. Some of them are ripening to the higher extent, so the better flavor profile they can achieve. And second important thing in ghee, some of the consumer which may send the complaint to the processors that your ghee has something which is a plastic kind of sensation, or the are those particles which are too hardened fat particles. So important is that how to process the ghee, and particularly a rural site, how to put it for cooling. So there are specific technology solutions, designs are available where danedar ghee or the granules of the ghee can be made, and a differential cooling, and within the cooling, which an intermittent mixing can be made. So those technology options are available. This is a cultured ghee, which nowadays that's why I have taken a Two Brothers. It's a NCR. It is also available. And if we talk in terms of we have the gulab jamun possibilities in terms of the market for the urban side of it. They either relish it in terms of the premixes and then they prepare it at home. They second have that caned gulab jamun, though the processor tries hard to be just fresh, but they are the fresh gulab jamun rasgulla is one thing which really can be offered through the SHGs. Or the small thing, standalone processor could be a halbai, could be. So those kind of options are really to be looked in. Different kind of cocoa based sweets, which can be really looked at. So, and how to look the problem, how to bring the problem, the product which could have a USP. So this is a small case which. This is a Chilka curd. So Chilka is the Chilka Lake area. That's an area which is well known and known for its flora and fauna. So in that region, the curd is sold in this specific bamboo kind of packing. And this USP of this particular product that there is a buffalo. This is a buffalo milk curd. And those buffaloes are called night queen of Chilka, because what happens that their owners, they leave them and they go out in the lakeside. They take the grass there, and in that tropical environment, they prefer to be in the lake. So that's why night queen of Chilka they are called. And in this curd, what is important, what is traditional USP of it, that it has a better shelf life than the normal curd. It has a thick consistency, and that's the USP, that why this curd within this pack is something which is contributed by the pack. So the scientist, this is a group of the scientists, I have taken their data here. So which is Karnal is involved and other institutions are involved. So they brought it out, that study, that why there is a higher shelf life, what is the mystery behind it, and isolation of the microbes, do they have any specific value in terms of the probiotic claims or so. So they made a formal study of the chemical analysis, microbiological analysis, means this is to convey that our own traditional products, we have to really see that if say it is a gheber, and which is topped with the milk part of it, if it is not to be offered, and it's a limitation of its fragility, its moisture taking. So we need to think in terms of the technologically what packaging options can be there if there are USP in the product. So that way they scientifically examined it, and the results are very, very encouraging. They found that there are 64 different microbial isolates out of it. Out of that 18 isolates, they were having moderate, the high to moderate kind of antifungal activity, and that was one of the region the scientists said that could be a region for the higher shelf life, and it was free of pathogen, so means fungal growth was not there for say 7 to 8 months, 7 days shelf life, good microbial count, and they say that it within that it is important that what is the treatment given to this packaging, intermittent sun treatment which they gave. And they just polish it up with the whey kind of thing, which dahi pani, which it comes out of it. So it contains whey, it dries up, it binds the pore so that the curd and the water out of it does not go out. It is already a thick curd. So many specialties. So if we have any specialty product, so technology solutions are available. Only thing is some scientific institutions, some nearby institutions to be contacted. And the product development like this, or the product screening like this, could be possible. Quick overview of some of the technologies which could be relevant. Development of some cheese, which the cheese is something now, even for the pizza region or for some other regions, which are the recipes which are continental or some other countries' recipes, they are being popular and people are preferring not paneer, but the cheese. So for that region, developing some cheese, even the chana-based spread cheese is similar to the cheese spread. that is possible. There is a ghee which is available that technology was patented by NDRI. They made Arjun and Arjun extract out of it. So they say ghee, which could be enemy to the coronary heart issues. But this could be something which is supporting for that fear which is there could be in the mind of the consumer of the ghee. So the technology, the functional processed cheese, even there are specially flavored paneer making, which could be garlic paneer, masala paneer. People, those who prefer to take the fresh paneer for them, this could be an option. And this probably due to the limited demand or the market size, the SHGs and the farmer producer organization can be really the taker of these kind of products, and the consumer, there would be certainly the market for it. Now coming to the another second, which so the dairy was one of the commodity which was the highest processed, and this is the area which has the least processing or the highest losses in also. As on date, I'll say that it's something 4 to 5% fruits, vegetable are entering into the processing, whatever primary to secondary level. In this particular segment, if we see fruits and vegetable, NHB report of 1920 say that we have produced 99 million metric ton approx and 191 million metric tons of the vegetable. So we are really the one of the leaders in this production side of it. But there are losses in fruits and vegetable in terms of its supply chain, more at the farm level and at the mandi level. And so within the before it reaches to the consumer, there is huge losses. So there is a scope for processing and handling for it. And when there is a poor infrastructure in terms of the cold chain, so the individuals can take care and they can really find the innovative solutions within that. And so that's why I would say that the small processing units, also even home-based units, common processing facilities at the rural level, they can be thought of in regard when we think in terms of the fruits and vegetable and their processing. So the value chain which goes from the production and up to the distributions of the supermarket, having the product like canned pineapple or some concentrates of the juices, even the fruits. Nowadays, there's a product which people prefer it for as a baby food, that the pulp of the fruit, which is fresh pulp and only thermal processed, no preservative added to it. So that kind of value chain is there. But where is the stake of the small farmers and the medium? So that is immediately after production and at the packaging storage level, and some convenience if they can add for some of the products for the consumer or a daily practice which a household has. What we need for it is the operations which we take is the cutting, cleaning, packaging. That's something which we means many of our household daily basis, they have to cut their vegetables daily for preparations. Before that, they have to clean. And in COVID period, the cleaning was really people taking it very, very serious, that do we really need to put a soap on it, or do we need to have the UV treatment on the surface? So though it's we are thankful to the nature in a way that the food has not been an inherent carrier for this COVID virus in particular. So there is an opportunity for it. That opportunity, if we look some technologies, some institutions which have brought in, if we talk at the level of the farmers, and farmers, if they want to link with the certain markets, they want to be linked with the industry as a backward linkage. They have to understand that what variety they are growing, what level of maturity they are picking it up. So there are tools available where they can determine, non-destructive tools are available. They can exactly know that what's the preference of the buyer and what is the maturity level when it could be picked. And then it can be brought to the market. This is an example given for CIFET technology, ICR institutions technology, which in this particular segment I would be talking much. And it is important to learn for the farmers that harvesting tools, which has been developed by the scientific institutions, and they have the specific directions, suggestions that at which point. Otherwise, what happens? if it is a mango, if you are wrongly picking it up and not stopping that sap which is coming out of it, it just spill over the surface of the mango, which would the site of breeding for the microorganism, and the value, which is the aesthetic value of the crop, will go off. So this is something, is a banana comb cutter. These are the small solutions or the designs which has been offered by the scientific institutions, particularly ICAR institutions, for when you are plucking it up, you are taking it down, and it should not have a mechanical damage. So food saving gadget and net waste system, or the poly sheet system when you are really harvesting it. And the grading is very, very important. And now the farmer has understood that what's the important importance of the grading. And I've seen the Punjab farmers, for the kinu particularly, they are aware, they grade, and then only they bring it to the market. Now, those were the items which were really talking about very primitive or the primary level processing. But this is an important thing, and which really gives an opportunity for where economy venture can be established in terms of if a processor, either individually or a group of the people, and particularly if it is a SHG, which is a woman driven SHG, they may really like it, and people would prefer for the convenience sake to have vegetables which are diced or cut or so. But equally, it is a delicate thing. Delicate in the sense means we are removing that natural barrier which nature has given to the fruit or vegetable. It is more open and more open for microbial attack or the spoilage. So there are specific technologies, tools, and the methodologies which the institutions has brought in can be thought of. In terms of fruits and vegetables, many vegetables, I'll say, even there are trials, and people have worked out the technologies where even cooked vegetables, they have dried and rehydrated. We have the many rehydrated versions available in the grocery and the supermarkets, but those drying thing could be possible even for the fresh, if it is there is a surplus which has not gone to the market, or has it will not have a real value in the market in terms of the size, which is a smaller size. So they can be really thought of for the making a dehydrated version of it. Like if there is leafy vegetable, which is like fenugreek leaf, and there could be like ladyfinger, which are dried and can be tasted. And there are small technology, small treatments, which could be taken care at the farmer's level. They simply need some slicer, dehydrator, vacuum. Dehydrator could be vacuum, could be solar, could be the electric. But vacuum fryer is something which is a higher side of technology. But if the farmer producer organization want to enter into that venture for the chips making, and particularly the snacking when we opt for the fruits and vegetables, then the vacuum fryer could be an option. Dryer could be also important in terms of the powder, like pale powder, or when we want to make some fruit toffees or aloe vera powder, there the dryer can also help further. This is a technology which has been brought some 8-10 years back by CIFED. They had kinu or the mandarin, and they are waxing, wax coating on the surface of it. So they developed, and this has been, they have outsourced it. So manufacturer outside are available. They give you the, so that there could be an uniform washing and then drying, and then putting that fruit to the line where it could be taken for the waxing. The chili processing plant is again a CIFED plant with a 300 kg per day capacity, but a miniature can, because this has been outsourced, so the miniature can also be made depending on the capacity requirement. This is a tomato processing unit, 15 to 20 lakh, it works. So this is again a CIFED technology. Mustard sauce, which is again CIFED process, they have customized available for technology transfer. Good white color, means close to white, they are slightly pale. And that kind of dried garlic slices, even it could be converted into the garlic powder. So that technology is standardized and available for transfer. for making different fruit bars in terms of that technology, which is osmotic dehydration technology. Both CFTRI and CIFET, these institutions are offering solutions for these dehydrated bars, or they could be in terms of those mango, or could be pineapple slices, amla candy, which we well know, it is well known. This is again a very small technology, and where even you do not need this kind of machine, which is a red and white color shown earlier. Even a hair dryer and the definite material which shrinks quickly against that heat. So that is needed, and shrink wrap gives, so that's a shelf life comparison. You see the Kinu tomato in terms of the shrink wrapped versus unwrapped. And if you are support, if you give support with the cold storage further, then which is double, or you can say that there's a multiplied effect in terms of storage. Quickly to have a look on it, sugarcane juice, this is a CFTRI, they say the stability of 120 days ready to transfer technologies. This is a technology, and though the fruit or vegetable part of it, but yes, certainly agro commodities, so that's why I put it here. Jaggery or jaggery powder can also be thought of. Improved Indian Institute of Sugarcane Research, so they have the powder technology, small rural site technology they have brought in, and that is available for it. So that's the scenario in fruits and vegetable, whereby what is needed is it could be a solar dryer, it could be a dryer which is natural draft versus mechanical draft, or there could be some fan which can operate through the solar power. There could be boiling pan and concentrators if you need to have jam jelly kind of productions. There are small sealers are available, weather cap or crown kind of which you put on the bottles kind of filling. There are one thing which is water washer is something which is simple. Frying a deep fat fryer does not much fit in, but the vacuum fryer serves better. But for the potato kind of crop, the deep fat fryer will help in terms of the chips. So chips, which is either dehydrated chips or the fried one. So depending on, and even the options of in a season like Navratri, which will come, so people on fasting, those solutions can be offered by SHGs. And these are the small packaging, sealing arrangement can be made. It's by and large packaging machinery. One is the hand refractometer, because you have to meet the standards, which are the regulatory standards. So these technologies can be explored. There's a list of technologies which are available at the site of CIFET. I have given a link here. In this particular category, I would also keep the mushroom, and mushroom goes also for the drying, the surplus of the mushroom, because there is a balance of economy in it. And when the market price is not there, there is a glut of production. So then options of the drying and off-season sell to the, which is a mostly to the dhawas or to the restaurants that can go. And even you can find if there is a good marketing. So what happens that SHGs, FPOs, they are able to process many of the times, but really the challenge comes to have their market linkage, not the technology, which most of the time they feel as a barrier. But yes, certain knowledge, certain awareness on the technology side can really help. Mushroom can come into the biscuit, mushroom flour in particular. Mushroom can come in terms of the nuggets like Amritsari Badi or the moon body, both kind of thing, and you can enrich them with the mushroom. So mushroom nuggets could also be a relishing thing. And this is something which I tested, and I found it a different people. Many of the times it could be appealing to some. When you turn these mushroom halves or the mushroom quarters into the candy, a candy, something which is a sweet candy similar to the amla candy. So that kind of production could be there. Now coming to the another area, which is quickly I'll cover it up, millet or the cereal product. So the what kind of machinery and the solutions are available at the small level. The challenges comes in terms of the cereals and millets or the other grains, that they reach the main operation is the milling, and there is whatever, say for example, today hardly people go for making it chakki and for a metro or for urban. They need something which is a pegged one. And many of the time people need a specialty atta or a specialty wheat or a mix of the atta. So those kind of opportunities are there where SHGs and the farmers, they can really cater if they can assure the quality product for this purpose. Going from, say, for example, mixing, blending, or the cleaner, which is simple jali kind of arrangements are there. There are, if it is you are handling a unit which is a bulk unit, and then you need to even condition the grain in, for the storage purpose, so then the dryer will help. Technologies which research institutions has bought, there could be colored rice, there could be colored wheat also available nowadays. There could be flakes, rice flakes, choco flakes, fortified snacks. So here technologies are more of the product side of the technologies where product know-how is available and ready for the transfer. Taking even from the millets, sorghum, upma mix, traditional rice, vermicelli technologies are available. These technologies have been different institutions has worked on it, and we have made one research portal, and on our NIFTEM site, we have highlighted these technologies. Important in terms of the millet, because millet is something, say, for example, sorghum or what we need in, say, for example, pearl millet, ragi. So these grains have a smaller size and a different processing challenge. However, the milling is possible, and but the shelf life of the products come, that is a real challenge because it has the germ which comes in it. And so the shelf life is many of the times, like example, pearl millet, it goes bitter. So there has been people who have tried the pearling and some devices, even dehulling devices, where the anti-nutritional factors can be taken away from it. De-stoners, which could be for the small capacity, there could be a possibility having small millet polishers on the surface of it, because extra fiber, if you really want to remove it. So it that is something can help, and the consumer preference, palate of the consumer, that can be combined, and the product could be better and more acceptable through these small scale machineries, which has been. The whole grain, if we talk, people really nowadays preferring to have the whole grain, and puff is one important area where you can put any taste in terms of the putting seasoning over it. And whether foxtail or the rice or the wheat. So one side it could be bhunja kind of thing, and another thing, these puff, those kind of things are mixed. And so a fat-free snack solution is available for you. So that marketing is very, very important, for which the different puffing options can be thought of. But a small vacuum puffing machine, which where millets can be puffed, which is shown the left downside. So this is even available in our pilot plants, and paper use, we can make it available to the user. That is how the millets can be put to the use. There are different technology options, ragi roti, ragi flakes. Roti is, it's a partially baked, and you can heat it up and consume. And ragi rusk, and so these has been listed at this by the CFTRI. There is a Nutri Hub, which is under Indian Institute of Millet Research. So they have also come up well with the product side, and at least 10-12 of the startups which has taken up their products and bringing to the market. One of their startup was using NIFTEM own pilot plant facility for their productions. And for that, flour sifter, planetary mixer, depending on the size, you can think of dough. If you're really looking for the bakery options, then you can come to the dough sheeter or the dough mixer side also. Because if you have some surplus from the cereal, some special formulations and product specialty, which you can cater in terms of the biscuit or cookies or the muffins, which could be multigrain muffin, which could be, this is anthocyanin-rich multigrain bread, which where the rice and even gluten-free could be made out of it. Our own student is doing good in terms of this biscuit. She's making it at the rural site of Himachal. So this is one area where technology in terms of the product and the sizable technologies, which the scale down, you can make it for fitting to the farmer and the need of the SHG operations. Honey is the one area where some automation has come up. There are quality conscious consumers are available. Recently, the people were concerned about the residue in the honey or the sugar, which is being mixed with it. So honey is something which is really looked by the consumer. Can we get the pure honey? And small players, aggregators, and those rock bee honey, which is purely by the collectors. So the processing machineries are now available even at a smaller scale. The kind of processing which goes up, such a melting of the people say that honey, which is not a pure honey, if it really solidifies, but no, it's not true that there could be crystallization in honey, whether it is pure, impure, that hardly matters. So you need a processing of it, you need a filtering of it. However, the heat processing is really a challenge for it. There are people who have a preference for unprocessed that honey also. So you have to simply take it, filter it, and if you can, important is to remove the moisture from the honey, because if excess moisture is there, it will enter into the fermentation fast. So if there are the small processor can use the dehumidifier, and the farmer producer organization, they can use the evaporators. Both I have depicted here in the picture, the lower two pictures. The first one is the dehumidifier and the second one is evaporators. In terms of spice and plantation crops, if we talk that there's a CFTRI technology which is available, I'll say that, because two crops I have taken up here, the one is turmeric, one another is the ginger. Both can be turned into the powder, can be dried, and the similar operation can go. But there is a patented technology which CFTRI offers. They have reduced the process time, particularly the treatment of raw ginger rhizome. So that is important, and people can explore that technologies. For ginger, it is relatively simple. You have to shade it, and then it could be solar dried, and dried, and then turned into the powder. There could be the if there are farmer producer organization interested in the processing of black pepper and turning it to the powder, jeera powder, or those kind of things where volatiles are high, or the flavor of the oleoresins are also there. So there, this cryogenic technologies are available. They have scaled down up to 30 to 50 kg per hour. And even there is 2 kg per hour machine is available, which is there at in their CFET Ludhiana, in their lab, and farmers can use it. Pay-per-use kind of technologies. There could be options of the technology. Similarly, there is for the meat and meat, particularly the mincing, the sausages, that those kind of options are available, formulations available. IFTEM also has a pilot plant, and we have a processing facility for meat. So these are the technologies which are listed at the IFTEM website. Those are mentioned here. There are important about fish. If you look, there are Sifty Cochin. They have brought up certain technologies, which is fresh fish finger, fish cutlet. So those are the things which even the SHGs can take it up. So there are domestic processing of it, and there could be the urban site. You can find the consumer for it. Quickly connecting to the pulses and oilseed, I'll say, I'll jump up. I think the time is also, I'm just covering my time. What means I'm close to my the deadline, what 1 hour is given to me. So for that, I want to keep 10 minutes for the discussion. So for oil seed and evaluated of the pulses, I'll say the moon buddy could be there. There could be packing of the dal, if it is a milled dal, if it is an unpolished dal and hand milled. So that also has a USP. Even hand-pound cereals, hand-pound rice, though it is a cumbersome, laborsome, but there are preferences people are having it, and particularly for the brown rice. Hand-pounded basmatis, hand-pounded even high-value rice people are looking. So that could be SHG-level operations. Only if the packaging solutions are available for it, and small packaging technology solutions are possible, and you can bring the product. For oilseed cake or the taking pulses or the roasted pulses, roasted grains. The bar kind of thing is getting popular, the energy bar. So that is one option, product option, which people can prefer. People can take it up, almond milk, which I have taken as a separate, so I'm not covering here. Means now, recently, I think some of you would have heard that FSSAI has brought a level on the vegan product. So the product which is neither from the animal, not even the meat or the milk. So that level, it is pure plant origin products and plant origin milk, plant origin curd. That is now being trained, even the plant-based meat imitations. And in particularly in this, the soya milk, which is one, which is a simpler technologies, cost-effective technologies, can be thought of by the farmer producer organizations. And one thing, which is a soya chop, that is possible at the shelf help group level also. So this is something, a soya milk, which is a success story of a brand is there. And people can also pick it up. There are some products like kombucha. I see in the Delhi market, only the small players are doing it. And this is possible that this could be customized and those conventional practices, good hygiene if you take it up. Kombucha can be possible where a tea-based beverage tea, which is a black tea and sugar added to it, and you simply ferment it and brew it for some time. Where alcohol, it should not really enter into the alcohol fermentation. So that kind of thing. And for that only thing is that you need to have a mother culture, which is called SCOBY for it. So this is one thing which I brought it for the purpose of the information, particularly. You need to have that symbiotic culture of the bacteria and the yeast, which is available from either some scientific institutions. These two cultures can be selected, and then mother culture can be prepared. Because traditionally, we have been doing the like apple cider in the villages of Himachal. We have been doing in the northern plains, the vinegar. So this is something close to vinegar and those kind of thing. Only thing is culture has to be pure so that it's a cross-contamination has to be prevented. Quickly, some thing which is important, I would like to highlight that what is important for SHGs and farmer here is the training is the one important component. Knowledge is the one important component, which brings the behavioral change of it. So that's an exercise which we did with some of the technologies which Neftem developed, multigrain pasta, kodo, kutki, lactation cookies, multigrain, so which we developed especially for the Kerala state, for their nutrition and health program, their state program. There is one important thing which I would like to show it here. This is a bundi or semi-automatic bundi thing, which can be preferred of different size and grade. And there is one more thing which we have brought. I think I'm missing that photograph here. We have brought it a nariyal pani kind of, which is a which could be a cart. And we have transferred the technology. There's a fabricator who can fabricate. And that cost comes between 3 to 5 lakh, which could be taken up by the vendors where you can directly suck the water from the coconut and take it out from the tap. So that's kind of thing. And the exercise which I was thinking that how the training really helps, how the dedicated follow-up really helps. We did an exercise in the Smart Gram initiative by our president, late Shri Pranab Mukherjee ji, in Haryana, Gurgaon, and there is one more village or one more district of which is Mebat. So we did it for, and we worked with some of the entrepreneurs there. The outcome was there that total employment generation was 49 out of 7-8 units with the investment which we can access to the credit was made through the bank 1.4 CR. So that's the value which helps. So means there is SHG and farmers has to connect with, and this is something which we were able to do it with our students in terms of the village adoption program. Student goes in the villages, stay, do a project there, and try to form SHGs there and to come out with the products which is FSSAI validated, FSSAI certificate is there, some formal packaging is there, nutritional parameters are given. So these are the exercises which can be learned, and the facility which I was talking, that production facility available at Neftem, along with the testing facility, which is NABL accredited. So I'm almost done with the technology side of it, but important is that we have to see that there are, it is not that we are talking this in air. There are success stories. Simple, a lady with making a pickle business with the 500 rupees investment, and now different four different companies she's owning. So this is a Delhi NCR story only. So if she can do, then I think everyone can do. There are many success stories. This is a bakery, which is a UE in terms of millet-based bakery products. This is a Gram Kul again, which I know very closely to the people. The Bajra biscuit were the huge success for them, and the farm fresh milk, both they are running very good. Gram Kul, if you will search, you will find some good videos. Even Doordarshan coverage videos are available. SHG is producing different biscuits. And for this particular sector, I said that in the beginning that if I don't talk to PMFME, it would be incomplete. So in this scheme of the ministry, where Prime Minister formalization of the micro food enterprises, and this there's specific support which is available in terms of individual groups, micro enterprises for branding, marketing, handholding support, making DPR, great access to the credit. Though this is ODOP based, but if there are existing SHGs, there are existing food processors, they can come even with the non-ODOP product also. Where the up to 10 lakh with that kind of subsidy is available, subject to the 35% of the total. That's the ceiling 10 lakh and 35% of the project. So whatever is less, accordingly, it will be calculated. Especially for if you look for in terms of SHGs. So that's a special capital. 40,000 per member of the SHG is a working capital for the purchase of the small tools. That support is available. There could be training, handling support to the SHGs, which is available, including DPR preparations. If an individual person want to raise the business, then he can qualify for the same 10 lakh 35% subsidy. So that kind of support is there. Finally, I would like to sum up that there are challenges. We have inadequate infrastructure facilities. Skill issues are there. Seasonal variability of the crop is there. So if I am really doing something for tomato that I did today, so the next day that different tomato is there. So those understanding has to be made, and for that training really pays. And technology, both in terms, we have to understand the technology, not only in terms of the machinery, also in terms of the product know-how. And safety hygiene is really a mandatory thing, which is a regulatory requirement. So the government is there to support, and there is a good ecosystem, support system is available. However, no shortcut to the success. At the end, I would say thank you. So that's all from my side in terms of the presentation. I would love to have more learning through the discussions now. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Upadhyay. I think what you have covered, I think the whole the gamut and the rainbow of the the post-harvesting technologies, like starting from the dairy, and then you have covered the fruits, vegetables, cereal products, honey, spices, plantations, fish, species, and the oilseeds, and later on, like, you know, how to link the SHGs to the, you know, the funding opportunities as well as some of the success stories. So currently, do we have any questions on the chat box? I think Ambassador Balakrishnan, I think we can take from the chat box only. I see one question here.
Right.
It is from Shiraz LA, that understanding the public-private partnerships in agriculture shows that the private players are highly interested in the market domain of the agriculture innovation system, both for inputs and outputs as well. What factors hinders them in investing in the agriculture research and education domain? What incentives in policy perspective can be formulated in order to increase their role in agricultural R&D investment? So this is basically, like, you know, what Dr. Upadhyay has presented. This is going beyond, like, you know, beyond, like, what he's talking about, that how the private sectors can be incentivized to be as a part of the agriculture R&D investment.
So because incentivization in terms of either the private players or to the farmers? Means both level, particularly if it is the private sector and they want to have a backward linkage, so there are support available, incentives available in the government scheme. So that is something which already exists, and people are exploring it, and through food park system which ministry has brought, I think this is taking place in the country.
So any one of you have any other questions, Meet or any of the other the attendees, any of the other attendees, do you have any question
in terms of the integrating these SHGs and the other entities into the food processing cluster? Where are the specific initiatives are being undertaken to enhance the technological learning? Okay, so this is an important point. I think I should have brought it into my presentation, which I missed. Under this PMFME, because we under our ministry, which is the Ministry of Food Processing Industry, there are two institutions which are directly supported and funded by ministry. So we are supporting two nodes, whereby we are trying to help the people on the capacity building. So both the institutions have divided the ODOP, which are around 135 individual ODOP, one district, one product, so different product range for all sector, food, vegetable, meat, and all that. So a small video clip, a write-up, a PowerPoint, what is specifically required in terms of the packaging, in terms of the safety, in terms of the regulation. So that information is made available. And if an individual which is either intend to be a beneficiary in terms of the subsidy or just in terms of the training, both can register on that portal. There is, I am putting it in the chat box. We run a call center also for it. So on this call center, they can link and can find the support that how they can register. Simple for me, they want, I mean, here the question was related to that, what kind of support specific initiatives are there. So technological learning, you can take it through the trainings and those. And if you want to go up to the handholding later through the bank credit access, that is also possible. So that I am putting it up.
Okay. So do you have any other question here? Can you have a PPT mail? I think you have, this is the number what Dr. Upadhyay you have given. Like this is the number of the...
This is number of the call center, where my team is there, which I am here at LIFTEM also at present looking this PMFME, that academic capacity building component.
Okay. So, Ambassador Balakrishnan or Dr. Amit, yeah. Do you have any question? Yeah.
I think we have exhausted the questions from the audience, and I think
okay, if not, then yes. You know, like what I was doing, because as Dr. Upadhyay was presenting, like his this plethora of experience, I also try to bring the problems what we face in the case of this entire ecosystem. And I would like to, you know, like, because each of this STIP lecture should go with some of the answered and some of the unanswered questions, which gives us the you know, the working directions towards that. So I, in order to do that, I have just made some points in one slide. I just want to share with you and the audience, and probably if someone wants to intervene or Dr. Upadhyay wants to keep some you know, like these things. So just a minute, you know.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I think, can you see it here?
Yes, it's coming. Yes, that's right.
Yeah. So what you know, like we have heard from Dr. Upadhyay, and also what we face, you know, like in our knowledge institutions, he has talked about CIFET. You know, he has talked about that the you know, the CSI, CFTRI, as well as the NIFTM. There are good technologies that are available, but really, when you want to go to at the you know, the community or the SHGs level, the local manufacturing capacity, that's a big, you know, the gap area into the, you know, total ecosystem. So I will just flag the issues, and probably, like, you know, Dr. Pada, you can comment on that, on and we can find it out. The technology, like, you know, you only told the technology solutions are available. How the real challenge is how to take them, make them available to the community organization, because I was looking into you know, like the website of that, and they are there. But you know, really, if I am in small level enterprise or SHGs, can I find like in whatever I need, like where from I can get it? In that context, the two most important thing is the upscaling the locally appropriate technology and really making it market viable. The next is the downscaling of the technology for the local need, because many of the technology you have told, like, you know, when I take it from a small scale, like how you can downscale, and that is basically the, you know, the R&D and the technological directions. Then the funding and the market linkage of the SHGs, probably the digital pathway, you know, like that can help. Like many of the digital pathway have been given, done by the the Ministry of Agriculture and the other ministries. The local enterprises could be developed. Like, no, you have to have an like, we do not have much, very still limited number of the the examples. What we need, that as we have got that the startups in the other domain, that really in this livelihood related domain, we need multiplication of the startups in that. And probably the last one from the RIS, like to comment on, why not in this domain to have an, you know, the advantage of South-South cooperation? Because, you know, the India's experience in this, in these sectors could give us a diplomatical advantage with the, you know, our neighboring country, probably the SAARC, probably in the BIMSTEC and the others. So I think this is, you know, the point what I summarize it, and Dr. Upadhyay, probably like if some of this you want to comment or any one of you from
that. Yes, sir. I think the scenario is still there are limitation in terms of getting an access to the local manufacturing capacities, but the institutions, particularly the institutions, they were having a mandate earlier as well, but really now they have been really asked to deliver in that terms. So they are linking and they are eagerly taking, and if there is some connect or some formal channel could be made, and probably in that regard, sir, we have an PMFME, there is a state nodal agencies that connects at the district level, there are resource persons. So if that is one good mechanism, at least for this scheme, which is for another 4 years, that will remain place, and they can connect to the institutions can connect to the those local manufacturing or the nearby manufacturing capacity which is there. Second thing, sir, in this regard, if you'll recall that I mentioned that NIFTEM research portal. So this is an idea which our secretary suggested that, and which we have tried to build in, so that whatever technology landscape is available from the different institutions, and that we are trying to capture and bring it onto one single that portal. And we are due credit and due mention that which institution, what is the contact. So that could be a one single source which we are trying to make it so robust that could be probably be helping in this regard. But certainly that challenge is yet to be taken up, and we need to really make the people understand that once it comes to the local manufacturing, they can further innovate and amend and improve it.
We need to develop that ecosystem, that enabling ecosystem, like, you know, from that, these institutes now going to the field. And then, as you have told, that the technology solutions and the, portals are available in the institutions portal. But probably, like, in the time has come now, we should have an one point, the access, that type of, the national portal, where anyone, can go and give their requirement and get it, like that type of thing. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, please, Dr. Upadhyay.
So yes sir. So that's yes sir. Your point is well taken. So that is something. There is something has been initiated, but yes, there is a lot more to be looked into and to be taken care.
So I think with this answered some answered and some non-answered questions, because I believe these are the main the points which we need to address in order to really develop this. The food processing, the entire ecosystem. So this is one sector. Similarly, the other sectors of the livelihood system needs to be present in the same way, so that that we can really develop that the the science, technology, and innovation based the livelihood strength, system strengthening in the country. Yes, Ambassador Balakrishnan. Yeah.
Yes, I think you have captured some of the important issues, and you know, many of these are common to technologies which are in the area of small and medium enterprises
exactly.
Like, for example, quite a few technologies that are there for manufacturing various products at a small scale level, NRDC and the NSIC have been in this game of trying to promote technologies for small scale industry. This is similar, I think, in the agriculture and food processing sector. I think what we need to do is to get a closer integration between labs like CFTRI and others and the field agents. Some kind of resource outreach centers need to be established with the help of state governments or local actors so that the technologies can be, first of all, made known to the potential users. Because a lot of what you have done is very, very important, but not hardly known to the public. And these days, things like YouTube and so on are there. For example, if you want to make something out of millet, you can have a whole series of YouTube videos which people can see and then, you know, apply this. So on the one hand, the technology awareness or spreading of that is a gap. The second problem is that you mentioned that a lot of activities in the informal business forms. Now, even in India now, even with all the reforms, setting up a business is very complicated. Right down from registering an enterprise with the MCA to opening a bank account, the amount of paperwork involved is quite a lot. I've experienced this because I myself set up a company, two or three companies. I've been through this. An educated and aware person like me finds it difficult. You can imagine what will be the situation for the ordinary person. So the process of registering companies, opening bank account, all these processes in our country are engineered from the point convenience of the regulating agency. They do not put the user at the center when they devise all these processes. But the result is that there are a lot of unnecessary formalities are involved and paperwork and if you have done KYC, you know what it is, and KYC is a must if you're registering any company or trying to open a bank account. So we have to, even when somebody wants to set up a business and going for the technology, there are a lot of hurdles in the way. So that is common to the entire gamut of business processes. Unless we can do something there, we will not unleash the productive capacity and the innovation capacity of our people. So we'll have to do something on that line. I think otherwise, been a very, very useful lecture. A lot of interesting things have come up which people do not really know about. And I think the fact that somebody has asked for the PowerPoint itself is a sign, because normally people don't, they listen to the lecture and go, but here people are wanting to analyze and go through the PowerPoint in more detail. So I think, Dr. Upadhyay, your institution will get a lot of queries as a result of this, hopefully. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. No problem, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Upadhyay, and thank you, Ambassador Balakrishnan and the RIS for organizing it, and to all the partnering agencies for organizing this 38th the STIP lecture. And with that, we end it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Amit.
Thank you, sir. Namaskar.
Namaskar.